Yeah, today on the show, I have a special guest, which is a friend of mine and also my photographer who does all my photography, all my pictures. So, and we're going to let, you know, as always, we're going to let my host take over with a couple questions.
Sure. Welcome, everybody. You know, we wanted to ask, like, everybody, like, tell us a little bit about how you got into what you're doing and, you know, a little bit about your history, and we'll go from there.
For sure. Oh my gosh, I don't really know where to start with my history. definitely been doing photography for a little while. Went to school for cinematography, actually, so learned a lot about filmmaking, and that's definitely a huge industry, but also something that's really challenging to get into. So an easier route for me was to head into photography, and that's where I'm at.
You know, we get a lot of, you know, interesting pictures in on our adventures and hikes and stuff. So I just want to ask you about, like, your experience in the classroom where when you were helping people, were you, like, coaching them to be a photographer?
So in 2015, I was asked, well, I guess technically 2014, but I was asked to come back and teach at the university that I graduated from. Specifically, a fun little history with that. When I was about 12, I actually started volunteering. My mom signed my whole family up. We started volunteering at the local television studio in the town that I grew up in. And, you know, started volunteering, and I started doing a lot of the local events with them, you know, just tiny little TV studio, but all the little local events, you know, dances that were put on by the local dance teams, different debates and whatnot. So I actually stuck with that from the time I was about 12 years old until I graduated high school. When I turned around, you know, 16, they offered me a part-time job. And so I was actually doing some work with them. So I actually have a huge, not a huge background, but I have, like, some background in event video and filming event video as a multi-camera shoot. So think, you know, like Dancing with the Stars or football or any of the sports or any of the, like, Academy Awards or anything that you see on TV where you have multiple cameras all filming one event and then they're cutting that live. So, you know, you've got somebody actually cutting between cameras. Think of that, but, like, on a smaller scale, because, you know, we had, like, three cameras. So that was part of what really got me interested in both filming and photography. So when I was in college, I took the event video class because I was already good at that. That's what I knew. And I loved it. I recognized that. And we kind of had a conversation about, yeah, this is, you know, I did this for a long time. And so then in 2015, I actually went back to my university and taught that same class. So I was teaching the students how to film with four, like, three or four cameras, doing all of the different college events. You know, there's always a ton of college events going on. And so that's what we were filming. I was teaching them, you know, how, not only how to film, but how to interact with the cameras, because it's a very different environment than filming a movie or even a documentary, because you don't get to stop and start. Once the event starts, you're going. And so you have to learn to troubleshoot on the fly. You have to really learn to work as a team and trust the other people that are on your team. You have to learn how to work with different cameras and respect that equipment. Find ways of not only keeping yourself safe, but also keeping the audience members safe, because you're also interacting with an audience and trying to work around them. And so it's a drastically different environment, but I loved it. I had so much fun. It's just a part, like, it's an every other year class at the university. And so I taught again in 2017, and then I taught again in 2019. Every year was absolutely different. I had a ton of fun every year. All of my students are fantastic, such bright young people. And, you know, they're so used to this short film and narrative film. And some of them were doing documentaries. So to jump into this whole different environment, and a lot of them are juniors and seniors in college. And so they're literally jumping into this whole new environment after going through, you know, 3 or 4 years of regular filmmaking, and just to see them start to grasp this whole different side of filmmaking and really start to work as a team and really start to trust each other. Super rewarding experience. Obviously, yeah. Since everything shut down in 2020, I have not taught since 2019. I've been meaning to follow up with the university to see if they're even still doing that class, because I know they've rearranged some of the programming just to kind of keep everybody safe. But yeah, that's kind of been my teaching experience. It's been really interesting. In 2015, I was like this brand new adjunct professor, just like, I don't know what I'm doing, but I have a passion for this. Here we go.
That's exciting.
Yeah.
And it says that you're an expert in your field. You know, that's what it says. But I wouldn't have you by my side if you weren't. You know, I love all your work. You know,
thank you.
And we get to.
You mentioned all those people learning how to work as a team. I think that's crucial to any kind of big production, you know, especially, you know, there's that quote that says a director needs an army, right? And
so true.
People have to, you know, for a beautiful film to come together, I mean, it takes a lot of sacrifice and a lot of cohesion, you know, to get the shot, to get the location, to, you know, do all that. So I think what you were saying right there, especially in that class, teaching them to work together, lean on each other, important.
Yeah, really finding each other's strengths and weaknesses, which is super important with any production, but especially important when you're doing a live production like that, because you can't stop a football game in the middle and be like, I'm sorry, we need to stop. Can we like replay that so that we can get the right angles? Like you have to learn to trust everyone who's there, and everyone has to know what they're doing. And I think that's like across the board with a lot of production. You know, whether that's film or even music, you know, you have to really learn to trust the people that you're working with to make it actually work. You know,
if you're doing really big shots, you know, you don't have the budget necessarily to do that shot 6 times. You got to get it right then and there. You know, the movie I always think about as far as that's, you know, and I'll ask you what inspires you, but, you know, The Revenant is probably one of the most magnificently shot films. Mm-hmm. Do you have any films that come to mind that you're absolutely inspired by and that kind of thing?
Oh my gosh. Okay. So the film, there's two film series that really inspired me when I was younger. I think I watched them around like 10 or 11 for the first time. And that's when I was like, that's what I want to do. I want to do that. And it's kind of funny because the two film series were the original Star Wars series and the Indiana Jones series. Both of them they're not necessarily super epic on any scale, but they're revolutionary in what they did. Star Wars, especially because the original series, just because it's telling this whole new story. It's introducing people to this whole new style of filming. I mean, it really did. And then a lot of the special effects that you see in the original series were done in camera. Like, all right, we're taking this and then we're shooting in front of a blue screen and then we're going to add everything afterwards. They weren't working with a huge budget. They had to learn how to, okay, we're creating this in the camera, essentially. Right. And so that originally for me was like, that's what I want to do. I want to make those movies. And then of course in 2001, when Lord of the Rings came out, and that was hugely revolutionary for everyone. A lot of my friends cite that as the reason that they wanted to go into filmmaking.
Wow.
And because it changed the way filmmaking was done, in a sense. It was a huge undertaking. And for me, as someone who really likes camera work, really likes the cinematography side of it, Lord of the Rings is epic because you have all these beautiful big shots. And, you know, they really jumped right in. They filmed all three movies within 18 months, not knowing if they were going to do well. And so that was another hugely inspiring one for me. And I could talk about movies all day long. but I think those three were like the biggest ones for me. But every year you get more and more just epic movies, really impactful movies. You talked about The Revenant, which, I mean, that is an incredible movie to watch. And it's so subtle with its camera work. Like, you don't have these big sweeping shots or anything. It's everything's very intimate. And so it's a very different style of filmmaking. But like you said, you get like one or two chances at this shot, and that's all you have. Right. Where other films, you know, you're getting 50 shots of everything. So it really just kind of depends. But even so, like, depending in both situations, you have to be able to trust everybody. And
you said your form of photography is a little different than like the movies, or so it'd be a little different than music as well. I mean, like, music videos, like shooting a music video. So we're more in the line of capturing the moment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I have some friends who have done music videos, and it is absolutely an entirely different form of filmmaking. And you're still telling a story. I mean, every film you're telling a story, whether that's a narrative film or a documentary or a TV show or a music video, all of it's telling some sort of a story. You just have to find the right way to tell that story. So music videos is not one that I've ever jumped into. It always really fascinates me. I love the idea of doing a music video. I've just never jumped in and done that.
I think something good would be like just capturing moments as life takes its course. You know, that'd be fun.
Yes. And that is, I definitely do a lot of that with my photography as well. I'm very, as Antonio can attest, I'm like, go do the things and I'll just take pictures of you. Okay, now stand over there. Now do this, like, just walk. So as a photographer, I tend to capture people living their lives as opposed to trying to pose all of these stage models or stage it. Exactly.
I can't wait till you catch some of those angels in the back, you know, because you got that that camera that's going to capture the moment. So, you know.
Yes. Yeah. And so I do a lot of that. My photography, I wouldn't necessarily classify it as raw, but it's not as staged as some photographers tend to be. I just, okay, walk over there. Okay, you can climb this tree. Okay, do this. Okay, sit there. And that way it feels more honest and more personal. And then you also capture all of those great little moments that you wouldn't if you were just posing people, which I think is a lot of fun. Yeah, it tells its own story.
I was telling my host about you, and then my former teacher, which is still, you know, a good friend of mine, you know, because we all go out. But I was telling them that me and you are also adventure friends. So, you know, during one of those hikes, you know, we could all go out, capture some moments.
Yes.
Yeah, with my host, the other teacher lady.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and they can join us, and we can get some pictures. And, you know, because I met him slacklining. He was climbing on a rope.
Yeah, it's awesome. Yeah, one of the parks out here.
Okay.
Yeah, well, are you based in Portland, by the way?
I'm based about 40 minutes south of Portland.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, so in general, this whole state is very cinematic. I mean, there's endless things.
Yeah, and regardless of what you're looking for, you know, you have options. You want to do a shoot on the coast, we've got that. You want the desert, we've got that. You want mountains, we've got that too. Like, you want forest, we've got that.
We got anywhere, we got everything here.
Yeah.
And that was the point, like, me and him went up to this mountain, King's Mountain. It would have been some...
Yeah, in Tillamook, yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
We needed some cat. We didn't have any, but it's like that. That was one of those particular hikes that I felt like would, after a while, be too hard for the photographer.
Mm.
You know, like, you know, some hikes are just hard. You know,
more challenging. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, she could do it.
And take photos.
All right. Yes.
What, yep. Yep. So, what kind of different? So you said you know you love taking photos of people in the moment. What kind of like different adventures have you had to go on to capture to get the shot?
Oh boy. So sometimes I'm running around and literally like running in front and running behind. I have climbed like the most difficult way up not a mountain, but like a rock face. I don't even know what it was, with a friend of mine, which was hilarious because both of us were like romping up there with our cameras. And just getting pictures of him walking through the forest and his little dog, like just posing perfectly. It was adorable. But then some of it's a lot simpler and, you know, there's a park right next to my house. And so I've gone out into the park with my mom where I'm like, hey mom, it's like, was it not last year, 2 years ago when we had all of the smoke and it was just like creepy looking. I was like, mom, put on something that looks post-apocalyptic. We're going to go do a shoot out in the park.
Oh, yeah.
And so that was super simple. Just us walking around and, me getting different angles and her just, you know, walking or collecting things and like looking at compass and, different things like that. I have driven a couple hours up into Washington and got to do a really awesome pirate shoot. So many people running around, all of us like in the water next to these waterfalls, climbing up.
I would have liked to be there. You should have called.
Oh my gosh, that was a lot of fun. I took so many pictures. I'm still sorting through some of those. So yeah, it kind of depends on what adventures I'm wanting as far as where I'm going. But I am not at all opposed to like climbing up on top of things to get the right angle, or I will very often, my friends love getting pictures of me doing this. I will lay all the way down on the ground to like get the right angle on something. Or I'm like cockeyed and yeah. So mm-hmm. I'm not at all opposed to doing what needs to be done to get the right shot.
That's right.
You took advantage of the smoke. The smoke was very cinematic. I mean, that was.
Yes. And the pictures turned out.
Scene.
It was. And it was such a, you know, that whole situation was so heartbreaking. And it was a very negative experience for everyone. And that's one of the things I love doing is taking situations and finding that silver lining, if you will, finding that good thing in a situation or turning a situation around so that we are seeing the good in it. So yeah, I mean, it was such an awful thing, you know, all the smoke everywhere and it looked miserable out, but then going out and doing these photo shoots, it looks so post-apocalyptic. Right. And I didn't have to do I did almost no editing on it and it just looks creepy. And I'm like, yeah, that's exactly what I was going for. So, yeah. But yeah, just taking advantage of
I think that's all those that's pretty important because I know there's some women like models or women who want to take photography and they were wondering like mm-hmm. How should they go about it, you know, their comfortability wise, you know.
Right. And realistically, photography is the way I approach photography is that there is beauty in everything and everyone has a story to tell. So you don't have to push yourself past where you're comfortable in order to tell a beautiful story and get beautiful photos. So definitely anyone who's looking at either becoming a photographer or becoming a model, just find where you're comfortable and find those stories that you're passionate about. And that's where you go. Those are the stories you tell. Those are the photos that you take. And then you just have to work with people who are comfortable with those same levels that you are.
somebody who's willing to work with you exactly. and see your potential. Because it might be spontaneous, huh?
Yeah, a lot of it is definitely spontaneous. But you absolutely need to work with somebody that is going to feed your creativity, but also respect your boundaries. And that can definitely get really challenging. As a photographer working with models, or if you're modeling, working with a photographer.
How long have you been doing it, since you were little or what?
So I've always loved photography, and I've kind of off and on done photography, but I have a professional camera that I got in 2016. So what is that? 5-6 years.
Professional. Yeah. Committed. Yeah.
Yeah. So I, got a good camera, got a couple of good lenses. And that's when I really started diving into it. But, I was doing camera work since I was about 12. And so you just kind of develop that eye for it.
Were you doing that at school, like in outdoor school and all that?
Not as much. Most of the camera work that I did was with the little local TV studio. And just, whether it was working with them to film one of the local events or borrowing one of the cameras from there and going and doing my own little things.
Now look at you.
I know. Now look at me.
Yeah. Grew up to be a specialist.
Yeah. That's what we're working towards. Definitely. Yeah.
And you probably got many different shoots out, many different professionals. Because some of my best shots that you see me in some of the biggest magazines came from you. So
yeah, yep. I always think that's fun. I'm like, oh, hey, that's my picture.
Yep.
Yeah. So yeah, I love working with people. I only recently started branching into real estate photography, which is a whole different ball game. But again, you're telling the story. You're telling the story of the house. And finding that way of making any space look nice, because that's the whole point of real estate photography. But yeah, that's a whole different adventure, and it's actually kind of fun.
Right.
You go in these houses, you're like, oh, this is cool. All right, let's find a way to make this look perfect.
Yeah, one day I'm going to have this house.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
That's great. I definitely wanted to put you your profession out there and let the public know, that they can get at my friend Adam, I'm gonna actually, leave, your name, and maybe your email underneath this episode. So if they to book a shooting, they can talk about prices and packages.
Definitely.
Email or something,
Absolutely. Yeah. I'm branching into the more professional side of it. A lot of what I've done up to now has been a lot of, oh, I want to do this, so it's available. But slowly branching into the actual professional side, where I'm doing shoots for people. And like I said, the real estate photography, that's a whole different branch of it. So I'm definitely up for, starting to photograph different people and telling their stories and getting their photos. So I very much enjoy it.
For sure. So yeah, it was definitely good having you on the show. Christian, is there anything else you want to ask our guests before?
Well, I just, if you have any advice with etiquette as far as approaching a photographer and asking them for work or that kind of thing, because I had a strange experience where someone posted on Craigslist, they said they were doing a photo shoot for like a chocolate company, and that they weren't going to pay the models because you could have the photos after or whatever, and they were going to be a big deal. And so I responded because I was curious. I was like, oh, that sounds fun. I was like, hey, my name's Christian. Here's my headshot, here's my social media, I'd be interested. And then I got this very strange response that was like, to be candid, we wanted someone that would research our Instagram and see if they wanted to work with us. And, you know, we don't want to have to, like, you know, I didn't really understand their response, but they said no, basically, and thought that I hadn't done enough, which I don't know. I'm willing to learn, but I thought it was a little bit of a strange interaction. But if you could comment on how those interactions usually work between clients and free gigs and asking a photographer for this and that.
Right. Yeah, that definitely sounds like a really weird situation. So I guess what I would say, first of all, you always want to keep in mind, if a photographer is asking for models, you have to approach it knowing what you want, first of all, as a model. So if you're wanting to get paid, be upfront about that. This is what I want to get paid. If you just want experience, then be upfront that you just want experience. But I think really keeping in mind that both photographers and models are artists. And it's unfortunate, but a lot of people try to take advantage of artists. They don't want to pay them. They don't want to, acknowledge that they're professionals. So as a model, if you're approaching a photographer, keep in mind that photography comes with a cost, and modeling comes with a cost. This is actually something I always kind of touch on with my students when I'm teaching, because we do go over things like wedding photography and smaller events where it's maybe just you or you and one other person. Keep in mind what the current minimum wage is, and that you are worth at least that. Right. So if you're going to charge for your work, keep in mind, because, you know, we sometimes get that imposter syndrome. Like, am I really good enough to be charging for this? You're worth minimum wage. Doesn't matter. You're worth minimum wage. So if you're going to work, you can get an estimate. Hey, it's probably going to take about this long. I'm worth at least minimum wage. And that's okay. And if people aren't comfortable with that, that's okay too. They're going to let you know when you can walk away from it. If you're approaching situations where they're asking for models to work for free, or even if as a model, you're asking a photographer to work for free, you have to make sure your both sides are really, really communicating with each other about what is each party getting out of this and where is all of this going to show up. Because if you're paying for it, obviously that's a whole different situation, right? But if you're doing any of this for free, then you really be upfront and really communicate about, all right, this is what I want out of it, and this is where it's going. But yeah, I always tell people, you're worth at least minimum wage. Keep that in mind. You're absolutely worth at least minimum wage. And if you've been doing it for a while, then you're worth more than minimum wage. Like, you're allowed to charge as a professional. And if people don't like it, then people don't like it. And they're just going to have to be okay with that.
Yeah, it turns into business, you know, after a while, to where, but you still have your friends, you get your friends and you keep, you know, keep them or at the family price or whatever, but and then the business, you know, which that's everything after your friends, because your friends kind of been there from the beginning, you know.
Absolutely. And you're welcome to make exceptions for people, like, that's fine. But if people start expecting you to make exceptions for everyone, that's where you have to start drawing lines. And it sounds like this chocolate company that you were trying to model for was had unrealistic expectations, considering that they weren't expecting to pay you.
Right.
Which does happen with photographers. They're like, oh no, we're definitely like, we're going to take advantage of these models, which again, isn't fair, because you're worth minimum wage. Bottom line.
At least.
And if you become more comfortable with it, then absolutely you can start charging more than minimum wage as well. So yeah, that sounds like a really weird situation where they were just trying to, like, take advantage of people and be like, oh no, we're gonna take advantage of this, and like, you can have the pictures, but like, you don't get paid for this. We're probably gonna get paid for this, but you aren't.
Right.
Yeah.
No, that's so, no. Well, no, thank you for your input. No, that yeah. sheds a lot of light on it. And mm-hmm. yeah, I hope people can get a yeah. little bit of perspective of how that works, you know?
Absolutely. Never be embarrassed about the fact that you are worth minimum wage.
Yeah, because yeah. those each of those photos are probably making money and who knows what different type of, you know, lanes, different business lanes. So
exactly.
This photo might go to a dozen magazines, and then okay. this photo might go to a dozen catalogs.
Yeah. Who yeah, knows? And even if somebody isn't making money on it, that's still your time. Like,
right.
yeah, it's you're dedicating, you know, 1 hour, 3 hours, however long it is, to that particular shoot. And as a photographer, you have to think beyond just the photo shoot, because you might be spending 3 to 8 hours editing afterwards, or 10 hours, depending on how many photos you've taken. So you want to kind of factor that into it, which I know can feel really overwhelming. Minimum wage is way past $10 an hour at this point, but if you're working for 10 hours at $10 an hour, like, that's a significant amount of money. And so you don't want to really sell yourself short. So don't just think, oh, I'm going to be filming or shooting for an hour. No, I'm going to be shooting for an hour, and then I'm going to be editing for 10 hours. So that's 11 hours right there. Definitely something to keep in mind. Yeah.
So my question is, I guess, so you as a professional photographer has a lot to do with the editing too, the shoot that you get, or the shot that you get.
Exactly.
If it's further away, it might be more foggier, and then you might have to do more editing on that as opposed to getting close-ups in certain angles and stuff, right?
Exactly. So you have to keep in mind, and this is like super important if you're doing things like wedding photography or event photography or event videography, because you will typically have drive time. You might have, you know, 1 or 2 hours meeting with whoever is hiring you. So you have to keep in mind the before preparation, the drive time, the actual event that you're shooting, or, you know, whatever you're doing, and then however long it's going to take you afterwards. So typically when Antonio and I go out, I will get somewhere around 500 photos. And so I have to take the time to go through and nope, he was blinking in that one. No, that one's out of focus. No, we get rid of that one. No, these two are almost identical. So which one do I like? And so you have to then really narrow it down to, okay, these are the best. And from there, then you're going through, do I need to correct anything? Do I need to do any editing for color or light or anything along those lines? So there's a lot that goes into it. As a model, like typically you're, you know, drive time and showing up. But you still have to factor all of that in. And if you are modeling and needing specific wardrobe or makeup, you want to factor that into it as well. So there's a lot that actually goes into it.
Yeah, you're right. Because yeah. what can happen is if it's a slickster, they might not be telling you that they're charging you for that. And then you have a whole big old, you know, fiasco, you know, like, hold on, I was just changing, but it's still their time. So by right, yeah. they can, you know, do that. But sometimes people work that in there in a conning type of way, you know?
Exactly. And so that's why it's always super important to be very upfront with models and photographers or anything that you're doing, really. But yeah, and that's why I think a lot of people are always very surprised at what photographers charge. Because they're like, oh, you're taking photos for an hour. Like, why is it, you know, $1,000 or $500 or whatever the photographer's charging? And it's because you have all of these extra things on top of just that hour that you're shooting. There's definitely a lot that goes into it. And you really have to think about all of that. But at the same time, people don't. And so artists often will kind of get gypped or set aside, or you get that sticker shock because people don't think about all of the extra stuff that goes into it.
Or you get those lawsuits We don't
or you get lost, which is not good.
Nah, we want to be the one doing the suing, not getting sued. All right.
Yeah, exactly.
let me take charge, y'all. The captain's here.
Yeah.
Watch out for those guys.
Yeah. So, there's a lot that goes into it, but just always remember, no matter what you're doing, your time is worth money.
We got two minutes left, you guys. Autumn, what can you tell the young ladies in this next generation coming up trying to be a photographer? What kind of advice can you give them?
Pursue your passion. Don't be afraid to ask your friends and your family to model for you, because usually they are going to love it. And find your niche. Like, find that part of photography that you love and just go for it. Obviously, I have a fantastic camera, but phones nowadays have fantastic cameras too. And so don't wait. Don't wait until you have the time or the money. Just go. Just go and start doing it and find what drives your passion. And also find your boundaries.
Yeah.
Absolutely find your boundaries.
Yeah, they got to be strong in this world, huh?
Absolutely. You know, yeah.
Don't get persuaded and, you know, stand on your own.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Well, Christian, what do you want to say before we go out? We got a minute left.
No, I just want to say thank you. Yeah, thank you for your time and thanks for, just taking time to show us your world and give us some good advice. And
absolutely. Thank you for having me.
We're excited to see what kind of projects you're going to have in the future. You want to end on like what are your goals? Like, do you still want to be in film eventually?
I would love to eventually do film. But right now photography is kind of my niche at the moment, and we'll see where it goes from there. Hopefully I can get some more projects in this year.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, we'll have you back, when you get some more projects, especially when you get, we're going to do some adventures, me and you, all over the country, all over the world.
Yeah, I'm excited.
We'll come back on and tell them how it went, how it's going. They'll see through the pictures, too.
Yes, lots of adventures and all of the stories along the way.
All the stories, all the experiences, all the memories. And all the moments, capturing moments in photography and in our hearts and everything. So